may be seated.
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of y'all again today. So in terms of announcements, it's looking like tonight, Sunday, January 29th at 6 p.m., French City Baptist Church is having a night of music and sharing, and they've invited our church to join them. If anyone would like to sing a song or share a testimony or a reading, just let Mark know. Then we're planning on having a business meeting February 1st at 5:45 p.m. Planning on having a firewood giveaway February 5th from 8 a.m. to noon. And do we have any other announcements?
Robert?
Yes. February 4th. Sounds good. Yeah, I was confused about that last week because my birthday is on the 6th, and I knew it was on a Monday, and I was like, well, I don't know if they're having it on a Friday or not. So, yeah, just remember it'll be February 4th, Saturday, February 4th, from 8 to noon, the next firewood giveaway. Any others? All right. Do we have any testimonies at this time?
I'm just thankful that Noah's doctor's appointment went well. He's healthy, and our baby girl is healthy, and she's doing well. So 20 weeks to go, so we appreciate all the prayers for her.
Yeah, we took Noah with us for the first time to try to have him see the ultrasound as well, and he didn't cooperate very well. He ended up headbutting me in the throat, and I was kind of upset after that. But thankfully, we had some good food afterward, and I was still able to swallow. So I'm pretty sure my throat still works. And it was a good time. But we all three of us got to see our little girl on the ultrasound, and I'm just so thankful for technology like that that lets us see what's in the womb, and just proves to everybody whatever your stance on the fate of the unborn. It proves to everybody that is a human being in there. Whatever euphemism you want to use, if you want to call it a fetus, go ahead and speak Latin if you want to, but it's a human being. Just so thankful to see that little human being that we'll get to meet very soon. And another thing, I'm thankful we had another edifying Sunday school class. We've been moving slowly through Ephesians. That's just because we get getting sidetracked on other important topics as well. This morning we were discussing textual criticism, history of the Bible, stuff like that. Something I'm very passionate about. So if you ever want to talk to me outside of the context of Sunday school, I'm more than willing to talk about it. It's something that I think we should have a familiarity with. Whether we're passionate about it or not, I think we should at least have some sort of a knowledge about it to know why we should trust our scriptures. Do we have any others? All right, everybody. So at this time, we'd like to look at our Westminster Shorter Catechism Baptist version. This week, we're on question number 51. And as we usually do, I will read the question, and if you would, we will all say the answer together. So question number 51, what are we specially taught by the words before me in the first commandment? And the answer, the words before me in the first commandment teach us that God, who sees all things, takes notice of and is much displeased with the sin of having any other God. So our scripture proof for today is also our memory verse, Psalm 44, verses 20 and 21. It says, if we had forgotten the name of our God, or stretched out our hands to a foreign God, would not God search this out? For he knows the secrets of the heart. So at this time, let us sing to the one who knows the secrets of our heart.
Oh, come and worship you. We just praise you for who you are and for revealing yourself to us, Lord. If anyone's here that does not know you as Savior, Lord, we just ask that you would speak to them and draw them. And Lord, use us as witnesses to them. And please use us, you know, as we go out throughout the rest of the week to help bring others to you, Lord. Be with the message that we're about to hear and the communion we'll partake in afterwards. Everything else that's done, be done and said for your glory and yours alone. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's great to be in the house of the Lord. Last week we finished Nehemiah chapter 8, and we've seen that their holy convocation, their gathering. Today we're going to exercise the ordinance that the Lord Jesus Christ has given us, is to take the Lord's Supper and communion. First, I would like to apologize for my collar. I'm not trying to make a statement. It won't lay down, so it keeps popping up. So I'm not used to wearing sweaters that often. Today we will eat, we will break bread with each other. We will remember our King, our Savior. Remember what he accomplished on the cross, the death that he suffered so that we may live. We're going to look, actually, if you look at your handout, the verse on the front, 1 Corinthians 11:6. We're going to start there with just one simple verse, and then we're going to go to a different chapter, and then we're going to come back. So it was, I think it's beholding for us to, as a church, to stand for the reading of God's word. It's descriptive, not prescriptive, but if you're willing and able, please stand for the reading of God's word. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Please be seated. Before I start us off in prayer, everybody, we're going to be going to Isaiah chapter 52, starting at verse 13. And we'll continue all the way through chapter 53. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Holy Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the gathering of your children. We thank you that we're able to come together as a holy convocation, as we learned last week, Father. To learn about you, to learn about your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, as we go through your word, press upon us the debt that was paid. Father, we just thank you for we are not deserving. But by your good pleasure and your will and your love, you made the sacrifice possible. That just payment for humanity's wickedness. We thank you, Father. Amen. We're going to start in Isaiah chapter 52, verse 13. Most people are really familiar with Isaiah 53. It's called the Suffering Servant chapter.
But this part of Scripture is also known as one of the four servant songs. This song is broken into five stanzas, three verses each. The other three songs are in Isaiah chapters 42, 1 through 9, 49, 1 through 13, and chapter 50, verse 4 through 11. These scriptures have been labeled to celebrate the sacrificial life of the Messiah through God who brings salvation and redemption to his children. With these chapters, they set them as a song. No worries, I will not be singing. But what I will try to do, I will try to expound upon that we can remember the death. Try to extrapolate, make a mental picture of the suffering servant, our Savior. This story, this song starts out in verse 13. It starts out with the exaltation of the servant, which is Jesus Christ. It says, "Behold, my servant." He's saying, call to attention as a king would introduce his son, the heir to the kingdom. We also, in the New Testament here, John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He will prosper. He will accomplish the Father's will perfectly. He will defeat death. He will be victorious. He will bring his children to the Father. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. He will be seated at the right hand of the Father." If we go to Philippians 2, 9 verses 9 through 11. It says, "Therefore, God also exalted him and bestowed him the name which is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, and those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Move now, it kind of translates from the exaltation of Christ. It starts telling about the life, the death, the burial. And it'll make a full circle back to the king. So verse 14 says, "Just as many were appalled at you, they were astonished, reviled. They were appalled at what they had seen. His appearance was marred more than any man. He was beaten beyond human recognition. His body, cat o' nine tails, chunks of flesh were stripped. A crown of thorn was pressed upon his head. He was unrecognizable in human form. And his form was more than any son of man. Those who looked upon him didn't even recognize him. And because his form was marred so bad, the blood shed so hard, thus he will sprinkle many nations." Verse 15. He's now performing the priestly sacrifice, that they would sprinkle the blood. The atoning blood will reach the nations all over the earth. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him, for what had not been told them, they will see. What they had not heard, they will understand. Kings will understand that their kingdom is temporal. But there is a kingdom, and there is a king who rules the heavens and the earth. And the power of the gospel will be revealed from nation to nation. And their throne and kingdom cannot dethrone the gospel. Now we'll move to chapter 53. It says, who has believed our report? They're changing here. The speaker is changing. Now it's the remnant is speaking. Their message was rejected. It's still rejected today. And to whom has the arm of Yahweh been revealed? The arm of Yahweh, or the arm of the Lord, as most translations use, that's an emblem of power. The gospel is the power. But who would that veil still remain upon? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot. Speaking of the frailty, he was 100% human and 100% God. Like a root out of the parched ground, he was brought up in humble means. He did not come like the Jews thought, as a conquering king that would crush the nations, and the Jews would be exalted themselves. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should desire him. He looks like just like every other Jew of the day. He was not a rock star. He was not trying to be part of the social structure. There was nothing until, as he was growing up, until he started his ministry, there was nothing that drew people to him. He was a carpenter. He didn't have a social status. Verse 3. He was despised and forsaken of men. No man has ever been reviled more than our Savior. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Notice it says sorrows, plural. The imagery is like a rock on the next of the ocean and the waves that are violently smashing into that rock. He is our rock. He was acquainted with grief. Familiar with grief. And like the one whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. He came to his own, and they did not receive him. Still today, Christ's name angers. They use his name as a mockery. His name is attached to a curse word. We don't dare use our mother's names as curse words. But we attach the Holy God name as a curse word. That's the vileness. That's how much he was hated. And it's still here today. And it will be there until he comes and conquers. Verse 4. Surely our griefs he himself bore. He bore our sins in his body on that tree. And our sorrows he carried. He carried him like the cross through the streets of Jerusalem. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken. They approved and they charged him guilty. He was stricken, smitten of God and afflicted for our transgressions. They esteemed him guilty. But what's verse 5? It says, no. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our peace fell upon him. It did not just be, it wasn't placed upon him. It come crushing down upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. But all of us, everyone here, saved, non-saved, all of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us turn to his own way. The Bible says, there's a way which seems right unto a man, but therefore the end is destruction. He is the way. But Yahweh has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Now I want us, everybody, to look at your Bibles, verses 4 through 6. And I want us to look at the pronouns and how they are put into these texts. We'll start with verse 4. It says, our, he, we, him. Verse 5, he, our, him, his, we. Verse 6, us. Us, him. That's a substitutionary atonement. He took our place. Verse 7. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to slaughter, and a sheep that is silent before its shears. So he did not open his mouth. Christ took our place. He was the substitutionary atonement. But like in Revelation, when it says the books are open, and the guilty, we will not have nothing to say before God. He stood on our place, so he did like the guilty. Before a holy God, he did not oppose God. Like a lamb, he went to slaughter. Verse 8. By oppression and judgment, he was taken. I put before you there was no greater crime from humanity. The injustice that humans put on a person. That person is Jesus. He is the Savior. And as for his generation, who considered? They wanted his death. He was stopping. He was telling of their sin. The light we talked about this morning. His light was exposing their wickedness. When you tell a man he's wrong, when you expose him, what's he do? He rebels. He gets angry. Who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living? That for the transgression of my people, striking was due unto him. So his grave, it was assigned with the wicked. Sinless Jesus hung on a cross with two thieves beside him. Yet he was with a rich man in his death. A rich man gave him his tomb. Because he knew that Jesus was a righteous man. Because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. Sinless. But charged as guilty for everyone here. But Yahweh was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If you would place his soul as the guilt offering, Yahweh was pleased that his just righteous would take place and it would be fulfilled. And his plan was perfectly instituted. He was pleased to crush him, to punish the sin of the world. But he was also pleased that his son fulfilled his will. But it says he will see his seed. He will prolong his days. That speaks of a resurrection, doesn't it? If he sees his seed, who's that? His children. So we see, we know he's living. We know at the third day we got the New Testament. We know that Christ was risen from the dead. This death, this horrific crime that was laid upon the Son of God, it didn't defeat him. He was victorious. And the good pleasure of Yahweh will succeed in his hand. God's plan of redemption, his perfect will was accomplished through his Son. And as a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many. Notice it doesn't say all. I know my sheep, and my sheep hear my voice. As he will bear their iniquities. We're bought at a price. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. Therefore, I will divide for him a portion with the many. He will divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out his soul to death. Notice he said, he poured it out. They didn't take it. He poured it out. Willingly, obediently, doing the will of the Father. That prayer in Gethsemane, he said, if it be your will, take this cup. But not what my will, thy will be done. What was in that cup? We don't like a taste of a bad cup of coffee. But in that cup was the vile, wicked sins of all of humanity. A righteous, perfect sacrifice. Had to drink it. Yet he himself bore the sin of many, and he interceded for the transgressors. But it doesn't stop there, brothers and sisters. He laid down his life, and he took it up again, seated at the right hand of the Father, still interceding for his children. He was victorious. His obedience, suffering, resurrection paid our debt that we could not pay. Verse 26 said to proclaim his death. That's what we are doing. Now, if you would, please turn back to chapter, or 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He's called us to remember these things, to remember what he has done. Each generation has something, a monumental event happen. My grandparents' generation was the Depression. And then led into World War II. There's people here that probably remembers World War II. Or they was born right at the beginning of it. It affected their lives. Their fathers come back. They go to Vietnam. This generation that affected them. You all can picture. You can look back in time and remember the significance of that in your life. My generation, I was born in 76. I don't remember Vietnam. But I do remember the space shuttle that blew up. I remember the wars, the Gulf War, the war that went on for 20 years. These are memories that stick with us. But I can't relate to the memories of the Vietnam people. I can read about it and I can hear about it. But if you lived it, it's a significant change in the life. But for the people who experienced it, it means a whole different meaning. This world cannot remember Christ with that same feeling that his children can. We become children of God. We read his word. And we see the suffering. Though we weren't there, we feel it. So we'll move to the Last Supper. I'm going to start, just give an introduction to it. Three of the four Gospels, the Last Supper is accounted for. The Gospel, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And the Gospel of John, chapter 13, is right after the supper. Verse 17 to 22 of chapter 11, Paul is rebuking the Corinthian church. They were making a mockery out of the Last Supper. In verse 17, he tells them that they come not for the betterment of the church, but for the worst. He charges them that they have divisions among their church, social and financial. He teaches on some Corinthian hairstyles. But he tells them to eat their meals at home. When you come together, this is for the remembrance of Christ. It's not a feast. It's not a celebration. They were bringing, rich people were bringing just platters upon platters. But the poor man had nothing to eat. What were they doing? They were dividing the people. We all know that the Corinthian church was really messed up. In that day, you didn't have to say that guy's a bad person. You could look at him and say, that's a Corinthian. And the world knew who he was talking about. Same as Sodom and Gomorrah. But I'd like to start in verse 23. For I have received from the Lord, which also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus in the night in which he was being betrayed took bread. Lord's Supper is going to be taken by Christians. We must make sure we are taking it. Well, I'll just go ahead and read it all. For I received from the Lord, is verse 23, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." 25. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This is the cup. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." Verse 27 says, do it in a manner. Therefore, whoever eats the bread, drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. It's not to be taken lightly. Communion is for us to remember what Christ has done for us, and to humble ourselves and realize that without his sacrifice, we would all be lost in our sins. There is a manner in which we must take this bread and drink this cup. If you have unreconciled differences with a brother or sister, you must try and reconcile that before taking communion. If you do not, you are taking it in an unworthy manner. If you have unconfessed sin in your life, you must confess it before God. Repent and ask for forgiveness. Verse 28, but a man must test himself, and in doing he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. He must test himself or examine ourselves. Must make sure we are partaking in this ordinance in a worthy manner. This is not a suggestion from the Lord. This is a command. Verse 29. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly. Verse 30-34. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. That doesn't mean taking a nap. But if we judged ourselves rightly, if we look truly into our heart and allow the Holy Spirit to convict us of any non-confessed sin, or if we have an ought with a brother or sister, have we reached out to reconcile with them? That's a division in the spiritual church. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord, so that we will not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that you will come, so you will not come together for judgment. Then he says, the remaining things I will direct when I come, Paul says. People, verse 30, people get the idea that God does not place judgment on his children. They think that's all in the Old Testament. God is love, right? Yes, he is love. The Bible is very explicit about that. I believe in Acts, Ananias and Sapphira were killed. That's the New Testament. Why is that so? God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. His justice is the same. His love is the same. His perfect will is the same. Let us not take advantage of what the Christ has done for us. And by taking and having the Lord's Supper as brothers and sisters, he's given us the way to do it properly. And just like in the Old Testament, when the Ark of the Covenant went to slip a little bit, and he stuck his hand upon it, he was just trying to help. What happened? He died. But what he didn't understand, if that ark would have fell, it would have hit dirt. We think that's a bad thing. Oh, it shouldn't have ever gotten dirt and mud and grime. But God says your sin by the human flesh of touching the holy ark was worse than it hitting the ground. Hebrews 12:5-6 says, "My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you are reproved by him. For those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines, and he flogs every son which he receives." So before we take part of the Lord's Supper, I'm going to ask us to examine ourselves privately, in your pew. But if God puts it in your heart, anybody's welcome to come to the altar. But let us remember our Father and partake in his ordinance the way he commanded. Let us cleanse our heart. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we must humble ourselves before him. Let us not drink his bread of life and drink his blood of the covenant with a wicked heart. Now, I feel it fitting. I'm just a visiting preacher. I've talked to Robert. The men of this local body are going to minister the Lord's Supper. I think it's super important that you're the members. I will take part of the supper. But I think it's best for the church to see their eldership, their deacons, administering it to them. I think there's a bond to that. I love this church. But I think it's fitting for that part to take place. So if we would, you want to bow your heads, whatever you, we're just going to take a few minutes of silence for everybody to examine our hearts, to think about what he has done for us. The vivid images we see from Isaiah 52 and 53, that beautiful song. you're still going with the Lord, please continue. Brother Robert, the elders, I turn this ordinance over to you.
Thank you so much for that sermon, brother. So while our deacons are while our deacons are getting that ready, could we have our brother Denver please pray for the bread and the juice?
As I prepare to read 1 Corinthians 11, 23 and 24 again, please get your wafer ready, and we will plan on eating the wafer after I've read verse 24. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 and 24, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was being betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" This time, let us eat the bread. And then verses 25 and 26. After I'm done with 26, we will drink the cup. "In the same way, he took the cup, and also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes.'" So at this time, let us drink the cup together. Thank you very much, everybody. So at this time, we would like to sing our song of celebration on page 101, "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." If you would, please stand as we sing this final song.
Give his only son to me.
Jesus, we want to thank you once again, Lord, for your life, your death, your resurrection. And Lord, as we remembered in this communion today, Lord, let us continue to spread that message to everyone around us. Lord, may we be one of the tools that you use in the salvation of your people. Lord, please give us a desire to spread that message to the people around us that we see every single day. Lord, help us to not be ashamed of your gospel and remember that it is the power of God for salvation. Lord, just help us accomplish your will. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.